magazine's editor-in-chief, David Haskell. He's here to discuss the magazine's latest issue entitled Inside, a Growing Terrorist Movement, which features a photo documentary by portfolio by Mark Peterson. In the issue, the poet, Claudia Rankine, introduces Peterson's photos, writing in part this: his quotidian look at contemporary American Confederacy and white nationalism shows us our neighbors in other robes. The people portrayed are living among us in every region of the country, in our workplaces, in our government, on social media, and for some, in our homes. Their culture is made up of both public rallies and private rituals. We see their homes and their streets and their schools, that these are also our streets and our schools and our neighbors. And David, I guess we should start out by talking about putting Klansmen on the cover of your magazine. I assume that's something you didn't take lightly.
No, not at all. Thanks for having me. We spent hours debating whether that was an appropriate cover. The whole project was a complicated one to put together. It's covering a loathsome group of people who appreciate the attention, and why are we giving it to them? But ultimately, Claudia's essay resonated with us, and the project felt impossible to convey without a striking cover. It was interesting, especially to us. The picture we chose was taken in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, not far from New York. And part of the power of the project is that it looks at white supremacist activity across the whole country in rural and urban areas, southern and northern states. So ultimately, it felt impossible not to do this cover.
So what was the principal argument for going with the cover and going with the story as a cover story?
Well, over the summer, we were introduced to this work as it was coming together by Jody Kwan, our photo director, had been in touch with Mark, and he had decided to take it upon himself to really explore in an ambitious way white supremacist activity as it's taking place all across the country. And that in itself was interesting to us because Mark was taking on a project at a you know, greater intensity than often, but we then did a lot of research ourselves to make sure that this was newsworthy. There's always been some fringe white supremacist activity in this country's history, but as it turns out, over the years, and especially this year, it has increased substantially. So there was really a news value, we thought, to making sure our readers were aware of the problem. I think that these can sometimes be understood as isolated incidents, and a portfolio like this can walk you through a year in America and demonstrate in its totality something a bit scarier than just isolated incidents.
No, I think, David, this is important because it's like roaches. They grow in the dark.
Right.
You need to put the light on in order to expose it. And I think that it coming on the cover of New York Magazine, not coming from people that head think tank groups on the left or a civil rights group like me, I think makes Americans look at that this is a growing problem. You have schools now where students have gone to school wearing KKK uniforms and celebrating this, and it's becoming too normalized. Have you gotten any clapback, though, from people for the idea of putting this on the cover and denying that, in fact, this was a growing problem in the country? Because data shows the white supremacy movement is, in fact, growing.
Yeah, I think the data is uncontroversial, impossible to ignore. And the Department of Homeland Security in September had recently just classified domestic white supremacist terrorism as an elevated threat. So there's a lot of just substance behind our argument. I'm sure there's been some pushback. It hasn't gotten to me yet, but it's Monday morning.
So you're calling in some reporting on this as well to understand the context, for these images. And I think an important question is always, what is the news? What can you learn? So tell me what you think that the reporting showed about the link between what's happening in the White House, what President Trump says on the one hand, and the growth of this more fringe movement on the other hand.
Right, right. It was important to us to report out and not just interview the subjects. We did that, but we also put some deep captions into this piece, and James Walsh did a lot of reporting, speaking to experts. I think what anyone will tell you is that, first of all, the movement is splintering. It's not just dominated by the KKK, but there's over 100 white supremacist activist hate groups out in the country right now, national. And there was a clear uptick in activity since Trump's been elected. There was also, by the way, a clear uptick since Barack Obama was elected. So you just see this deep American story of a ongoing cockroach problem that gets that can flare up in times of a sort of a galvanizing presidency, in times of a president that scares these people. But it's clear that people who are worried about American domestic security are paying attention to this in a way that they haven't before.
Did you come away, David, with any sense of what their agenda is in the near term, like over the next couple of years, given this uptick, what they might actually do?
I didn't really, and I wouldn't say that it's an organized movement. I mean, part of the splintering is similar to what you would see in any global nationalist movement. There was one person we spoke to in the movement who predicted that, or who thought that the Trump administration was actually quieting them down because it gave their sympathizers a false sense of progress. So in that sense, he was sort of rooting for a more dramatic conflict. I think that individual probably enjoyed the Obama presidency more. But it's really hard to tell what any of them are looking for, or even I think it would be a mistake to imagine a rational or political point of view. I think it's a organization or a belief system driven by very base feelings.